Our talks, March edition. Please put your hands together for Padma Shri, Mr. Muhammad Ali Beg, ladies and gentlemen. He's a renowned theater personality. He's a playwright, an actor, a director. This gets very interesting now. He's popularly referred to as the global face of Hyderabadi theater. He's also known as the Sultan of Epics and the Master of Revival. These are the titles that have been given to him for the wonderful work that he has done all these years. He has received many prestigious awards around the world. He received the prestigious Padma Shri Award in the year 2014 for his contribution in theater arts. He's an ad and documentary filmmaker. He has been conferred upon with more than 40 international laurels and awards for some incredible work that he has done in ad filmmaking and documentary making. And last but not the least, at a very young age, he has already shot, produced and directed more than 400 ads and documentaries. I think I can go on for the next 2 days, but I'll have to stop somewhere. So let me stop over here and please invite on stage Padma Shri Muhammad Ali Beg. Please come on stage, sir. And may I also take the pleasure of inviting his one and only wife, who's a gorgeous lady. That's a good question that Mr. Beg asked. How are you so sure? I would like to pretend that I'm sure, at least on stage. She looks absolutely graceful, gorgeous. Noor, wonderful having you over here. Thank you so much for your time. Well, if Mr. Beg is a very... Please have your seat. Is a very renowned personality. She's no less. She has been an ace theatre personality for almost 5 years now. From 2014 onwards, she has been a part of the Beg Foundation, the Theatre Foundation. She has performed worldwide. Some of her originals have received standing ovations around the world. So how does it feel? Do you guys play with each other when you're at home, theatrically?
We play, period.
Okay, so how does it work? Okay, as a couple, it's not always easy to be on the same page. Are there disagreements and then agreements? How does it work? Let me hear it from the lady. Because yes, generally they are the ones who disagree. Men are fine. We kind of agree.
It's really interesting because a lot of people ask us that, in fact, because they say, how do you work together? Because couples don't usually belong to the same industry. And some people, on the other hand, say, oh, it's wonderful that you both met each other and both of you are so creative and it's just a perfect match. But the reality of it, I think it's a day-to-day process. And we both are on the same page in general in terms of our approach to life and principles and values and the things we like, the things we appreciate. So that flows into our work. Yes, of course there are disagreements because we write together as well. And when you write together, naturally, there'll be some differences of opinion. But it's worked out pretty well so far.
Has it been a pressure getting married into the first family of Hyderabadi theatre? Did you have this background before you got married to Mr. Beg, or it happened once you became a part of the family?
No, I'm not from a theatre-related background at all, from a very academic background, but very into the arts.
By the way, she has masters in international relations. When yes, she talks about academic background, she's quite a studied lady. Yeah.
It's a very different field that I come from, but there was always this affinity towards the arts and performing and writing, and it was very well encouraged by my parents. Mm-hmm. So it was always something I did, but it was not something you think of as a profession, as Apeksha was saying just now. It's something like it's a hobby or it's a good pastime, and fine. My parents, in fact, were a little more broad-minded than others. They wouldn't mind me staying up late at night and writing and making up stories, which didn't have any productive value in terms of school or any other extracurricular activities, just for creative pursuit in itself. So when I met Mr. Beg, what struck me at first was what I've seen of theater growing up is it's something every college kid does. But it's not something you take up as a profession, you dabble in it and then you move on. But the kind of foundation that he had built, and in a city like Hyderabad, which, coming from Chennai, I have not really heard or associated Hyderabad with theatre as such. It was more of, you know, pearls and the cuisine and the culture and everything. So when I read about him and saw his work, I was amazed that he brought this level of professionalism and prestige to such a craft and treated it with a complete professional approach. And it's like there's a proper office and rehearsals at a certain time. And it's not just to hang out. It's to actually produce art. And
that is some of the finest in the world. Not ordinary art. By no stretch of imagination, any ordinary art. By the way, I don't know if you know enough and more about Mr. Beg, but he comes from a family which is considered to be the first family of Hyderabad theatre. As I mentioned earlier, his father was one of the most renowned artists that Hyderabad produced. And I think you got into theatre and acting and directing and all pretty early in your life, right? I think you also studied in Bangalore, and at a very young age you started directing some seniors as well because of your prowess. Tell us more about your journey.
Very interesting, because yes, having born into theatre, it's a responsibility. The legacy is a responsibility, and I take it forward with to the best of my ability, professional aesthetic as well. But initially, I ran away from it. I was born into theatre, grew up loving the fragrance of the freshly printed tickets, manning the box office at a certain age where I was not even as high as the box office window, but I would love to sit there. I still love the box office. I lost my father in preteens, just before debut play. I was to debut on stage in his play, and I lost him. So that is something that left a huge scar on the family's mind, on my mind, and I sort of ran away from theater, and as far as I could. So I didn't want to be seen around theater, to belong to theater, or to have anything to do with theater. And as I was growing up, moving images caught my fancy, advertising caught my fancy. I still love doing ad films, doing documentaries, social documentaries. There was certain morbidity and intensity in theater which I don't like. And that's why even if you see most of my plays celebrate life, they're not morose, they're not depressing, they're not, because I don't believe personally that you should take out your inner angst on
stage.
That's
an interesting observation, I must say. There are quite a few theatre artists out here
I'm sure.
So there is a certain morbidity about theatre which
I personally feel. People may or may not agree with it, but I having born
so
into it,
you want it to be more vibrant, celebrating life?
That's okay. What sort of baseline is for foundation celebrating.
Is that the reason why you choose to have very royal kind of sets, very royal kind of plays, like huge, I don't know how to put it
as
in
I
words.
As I said, it's celebrating.
Pretty much you're like the Sanjay Leela Bansali of a theatre.
No, he came in much later into the business.
Exactly. No, I'm just taking it as a reference point, isn't it, in terms of
larger than life. You have to be authentically correct with your intrinsic details when you're portraying. Not every heroine can sort of stop at that. As I said, celebrate life, which means present the best of the fineries of life on stage, is what I would like to present. But due respects to everyone who has all the social issues, all the whatever they call it on stage, but I perform for audience, and that's the basic premise. Why I'm into theater today is to pay tribute to Baba, and for my audience. Now when I do a play, when we write a play, when I direct it, envision it, produce it, my mom produces it, Begum Razia Beg, most of the time, the first call I take is, if I'm sitting there in the audience chair, would I be with the actor for the next hour and a half? You know, it also depends on the target audience, the profile of the audience. Now if today, when at the touch of your smartphone, you have every infotainment, entertainment, edutainment, whatever you
readily
call it.
Readily available.
Readily available. I mean, in your living room, in your office, while you're driving in your car, sitting in a bus, wherever. If audience drives or takes a public transport for an hour, spends an hour coming to the venue, spends a couple of hours here, goes back spending an hour, half an hour, devotes 3-4 hours of your life on a weeknight or a weekday, it better be worth it. And there has to be a takeaway of it. So what I do is I present my theater in a way where it draws more and more audience. You know, I don't want, it depresses me to see more people on stage than in the audience. touch wood, it never happened. But there are people who do that. People who say, oh, I don't mind.
Do we as a country need to overcome that? Because theatrical presentations, musical presentations overseas, abroad, you know, there are tons of people who come and watch. But somehow in India, unfortunately, though there are many theatre lovers out there, there are many people who love this form of art, but theatre hasn't really been able to garner so much of money as compared to other mediums. Would you agree with me on that?
There's money in theatre. Anyone who says that there's no money in theatre is either lying or doesn't know their job. It's as simple as that. It's your approach which gets you money, right? I haven't had a Bollywood release to my credit. I haven't done a television serial yet. I sell at a price where in US and UK, touch wood, where no Bollywood star can touch that box office. It's purely on the premise of my theatre. Take five names in the country.
Are you also lucky that somewhere you carry that legacy along with you? Or is it something that you believe that you have built over
the years? There are few other families in the country who carry that legacy. You know, we are a legacy without a venue in Hyderabad. There are people in other cities which have a legacy and a venue which comes to their aid to promote theatre. Even then, they are where they are, in 70s and 80s. I take this example very often. People who love cricket, I'm sure you do and others do. We had master batsman called Sunil Gavaskar, and he has a record of carrying his bat through in a World Cup. 36 not out in a 60-over World Cup match.
Correct.
What if such a batsman is playing today? Where would he be?
Nowhere. He would not even.
When the requirement is 36 runs
in an over. In an over.
You can't carry your bat through in a one day.
Would you believe that?
So theatre also has to see that change. Theatre practitioners have to overcome that. You can't pick up 70s and 80s written classics in quotes and subject your audience to misery 500th time, 600th time of the same play. Themes have changed. What was women's emancipation in 70s is no more women's emancipation in 2018-19.
Correct.
What was not progressive then doesn't remain the same today.
So do you have to change with changing times? Is that the message that you want to
give out?
Then
you will know how to make money in theater. What I'm trying to say is you can't sit with a mainframe computer.
I also want to hear, see, I'm not such a huge theatre expert myself, but I'm not such a huge proponent as well of theatre. Of course, I love the art form and I think he's making some very, very valid points, because somewhere I also see a marketing guru in Mr. Big, apart from being a theatre personality, because somewhere you believe that unless any art form is commercially viable, you cannot sustain it for a long period of time. Would you agree with me on that? It needs to make money, and that's how it will grow. The industry will grow.
The best artists in the world are the most commercially successful ones that you hear of.
Absolutely.
If there was a pure artist, pure dancer, pure musician, pure artist, pure theater actor, he wouldn't have been known out of his town, his city, his country. And that's why I give this example that if you talk of top five names in theater today, you talk of people who have had Bollywood innings. You talk of people who have had television innings. The just two names in the country who, on the merit of their pure theater work, could become stars. Now, why are there just two people in the country? There are no more. Late Khadir Ali Beg Sahab, late Habib Tanveer Sahab. Baba's plays here, the other theater guys in town will tell you that a 5 rupee ticket would be sold in black market for 50 rupees. Again, without a Bollywood.
For a theatrical.
For a theater. For pure theater. Theater without item numbers, theater without, you know, those television dance, soap opera dance, or whatever. So if you know how to first produce theater, which audience can accept, right? With which you multiply your audiences, and so, know how to pitch it.
So do you also believe in delighting your audiences because you want them to come at a certain cost? At the end of it, if they are leaving everything aside and choosing theatre over other forms of entertainment.
That's what I'm saying. So today, if you're doing that, why should they come and watch theatre? One is a star appeal, X is performing, or you have Y playwrights play, which is known around the world. That's being staged here, staged by this director. So in a different form, in a different adaptation, yes, we're going to watch it. But at the end of the day, if you want, this is all okay. I mean, theater gives you the cake, theater has no retakes, and theater, all that is okay, fine. I mean, that's okay for 30, 40 audience, et cetera, et cetera. When you're pitching to an audience of 1,000, I inherited, lucky to have inherited about 300 audience base from my father. But I had to sort of, as they say, burn midnight oil to convert that 300 to 1,500.
Right.
Without compromising on the decorum or the sanctity of theater. We never sell out. Yet the box office is sold out. So we need to have that professional maturity. I mean, if I...
So what is that unique selling point in you vis-a-vis the other theater artists and directors and producers and all that probably you are so successful, they are not. Some of the stories, as you mentioned, if the story is redundant, if your presentation is redundant, you'll only get about 40, 50 people from your families who'll come and say, very well done. We are so proud of you. You moved us. That's about it. It's not taking them anywhere. As in, we are being very realistic, and please don't get offended, anybody who's from the theater industry, if you believe that what you have been doing is phenomenal. This is I think, a very productive conversation, because I understand...
Even if they're offended, they better be, because that's where the change would come in.
I am not in the position of authority to offend anybody, because I'm a nobody in theater.
First of all, to answer your question, I may not be the right person to answer that. It probably a third party should evaluate that and tell you. What I can say is that if you have to attract more audience to theater today, you have to give them what they want and not scare them away with those, again, set norms of theater.
So what is it that you believe people want in theater? In your theater, let's assume.
Intellectual stimulation. You know, that's one word that I would say they carry back from my productions. Mm-hmm. You know, rest in a auditorium of 1,500 people. People have their opinions. 70% has one opinion. 20 would have another opinion. 10 would have a third opinion. You're discussing that. It was humanly impossible for the young designer there. It's humanly impossible to satiate and satisfy 10
Everybody.
Out of 10 people. No master of arts, no fashion designer, to my knowledge, had been able to do that. You know. So, with theatre.
See, the answer that you gave me is still pretty open-ended, because the moment you said intellectual stimulation, I'll give you a live example that we had. Venky intellectually stimulated me. Yeah? He spoke about very, very real life situations,
right,
wherein his street smartness took him to a certain place. That was intellectually stimulating.
In his own way, in his own dialect,
correct,
without pretenses,
okay,
true, honest. Now that intellectually stimulated you.
Fair enough. I'm actually asking questions on your behalf. So you need to applaud for me, because the answer was meant for you, not for him. Okay, fair enough.
So you
I think
see,
that's an interesting point that you
that's
made.
A parameter. You saw Venky, you saw his, let me call it, rusticness.
Correct.
Right?
His very down to earth approach.
His originality.
And that's a compliment.
It is. His originality, as I said, no pretenses.
Right.
No false benchmarks. Right? He doesn't have a Fellini here and a Fellini mystery there and whatever.
He wanted to do was to make money by clicking the street vendors at that point in time, and I have immense respect for that. Because
he had his, as much as I heard him, he had his eyes open, as much as his mind was alert to the environment, to the surroundings, to what he was pitching to do, what he was wishing to achieve. Right? He was very clear. Now, he could be from Karimnagar, he could be from Cincinnati, he could be from...
Anywhere in the world.
New York. He could have come from the fanciest film school or the cinematography school. If you don't have that conviction, if you don't have that clarity of thought, that fire in the belly, you don't achieve. You don't go beyond the rat race.
So somewhere, do you believe that somebody like a Venky or even somebody like you, because you've got that clarity of thought, at least in the theater space...
I would like to believe
like
that.
To believe that. Fair enough. So, no, I think we would like to believe that you have that clarity of thought, because you have attained a certain stature as far as theatre is concerned. So, is it more, and since you gave an example of cricket, so can I relate it with somebody like a Virendra Sehwag, with a very simple, clean mind, go there, entertain the spectators who have come there, play for them, play your shots, you get out, you go. You strike a century.
Entertaining is something different than being responsible to your team and the requirements of the team.
However, you are also responsible for entertaining those 1,200 people who are coming and watching your theatre.
That's why I used the word intellectual stimulation. If they are looking for entertainment, they are doing. We are not talking of the playing to the gallery's entertainment.
Okay.
When I talk of intellectual stimulation, I don't mean over the top art.
Okay.
I'm basically against over the top art.
Oh, okay.
And theater is not. Theater is a very visual medium.
If I am to ask you to define your TG very, very specifically. Very, very specifically. Okay, before that, I just want to briefly interrupt. Are we making sense? We are, right? Don't tell me after the show, kya pooch raha tha. Imandari se batao. Are we making sense?
Yeah, kya bol raha tha.
And I would love to, you know, have your inputs as well. I think it's a pretty compelling conversation because I kind of, you know, I'm trying to dig in more to find out what his school of thought is. And that is my endeavor. So if you want to join in, please be my guest. And anyway, so what's your target audience?
Let me caution you that I speak with that conviction and passion that I do my theatre with.
Which is what we expect. We expect nothing less than that.
Thank you. 1500-2000 ki audience mein target audience define karna bada mushkil hota hai. You know, because you're not selling soap and shampoo.
Correct.
In an ad film that I'm doing, I have my product very clear. It's a premium product. It's a product for, as they say, you know, the common man. It's a product for the rural audience, etc., etc. You know how to pitch. You know how to define the story. Here, if I do produce a play, if I do present a play, I would say the entire city where I'm performing is my target audience. Mm-hmm. I don't succeed in getting all of them. I succeed in getting people who are initiated into theatre, people who I initiate into theatre. It's extremely fulfilling when, as I said, after a show, people come in and some of them walk up and say, sir, this is the first time I've come to theatre. And believe me, I'm going to watch theatre from now. The young girls come in during the festival and say, sir, I've just come out of school, college, whatever. And they're the first play I've watched in life. So with boys, first play I've watched in life. And thank you for giving us this opportunity to watch.
There's a starking similarity between our Honorable Prime Minister and Mr. Baig. While he's excited about first-time voters, Mr. Baig is very excited about first-time theatre watchers.
He has been, I think, for 4.5 years. I've been for the past 15 years, less mercilessly, peacefully.
Right. So you believe that it's always an excitement when you have, and I want to take Noor's inputs as well. Noor, you have been listening to our conversation. Did we bore you?
No. It's something I'm involved with every day.
And so, okay, so you're very well aware of his thought process, his school
Absolutely,
of thought and all that
yes.
stuff. Are you perfectly in sync with his school of thought?
Yes, I think I am because, I mean, as we perform around the world, these are the experiences that I've shared along with him. And it's very interesting to see some of the greatest theatre people who we grew up watching. They come and appreciate our plays as well as someone who's come for the first time and who's only watched films and this is their first play. So, you know, I mean, they're like, how do you learn those lines? How do you remember so many dialogues? From that to someone who's, you know, seen the best around the world, to have that kind of varied audience is really fulfilling because you see a diversity of perspectives.
Correct. That is the artistic satisfaction.
Yes.
Let's ponder over the commercial satisfaction part of it, wherein he made a very valid point saying that unless you modernize yourself, it happens with technology. See, evolution is a very, very organic process. Unless you evolve, you don't exist. Yeah. Or you risk being eliminated. You know, dinosaurs, irrelevant. Because they could not evolve, that's why they don't sit
exist,
with us in the auditorium.
Or you exist, but not heard of.
Correct. Exactly. So, how much do you believe in the fact that theatre needs to evolve in India for it to become an industry, which probably it not is as of today?
I think as of now, all throughout the media, we've learned that content is king. I mean, I think that's coming up in films only now, but with theatre, it's always been about the content. And I think that's what that depth, that originality, the truth in your content is what attracts people and keeps them, you know, attuned with you. So that's something we've found when we write and when we perform. Those are the kind of stories which reach out across the fourth wall and connect with people. That's where it's, you know, we're intellectually stimulating them, we're emotionally evoking a response from them. That's what stays with them and that's what they take away. So that's what I think is further to what he was talking about in how...
I just realized between the two of you, he's the businessman. He is the businessman and there's nothing wrong in that.
That's a good thing.
Do you agree? Would you agree?
Yes.
He is the businessman, right?
Yeah.
Mr. Baig, you are the businessman. You're an artist who's a businessman. Again, I'll draw an analogy and it has got nothing to compare the two of you, but you are like the Shah Rukh Khan of theatre industry. Just an analogy, I have got nothing to do with it.
I'm not sure why arts theatre is differentiated from commerce.
Which means you agree with the analogy, to begin with.
I don't want to answer that question.
No, you need to market. You need
I just share an example. Okay. Just last evening, the Asian Arab Chamber of Commerce gave me a UAE award for international theatre. Now, Asian Arab Chamber of Commerce, they have nothing to do with theatre. They have nothing to do with the arts, nothing to do with performing arts. But they realized that here is a theatre repertory in India which has made theatre professional, commercially viable, a model that France, other companies in UK share, touch wood. I've been invited by the French government and others to share the revival model, to share the repertory's commercial model.
Is that the reason why you have been called the master of revival? Is that where it stems
from? As I said, it's not for me to answer those questions, because if international press has given those titles, they have been kind enough, and I'm honored that they found me befitting of those titles. But I'm not getting into why they haven't called me that. If M.F. Hossain Saab wasn't commercial, we wouldn't have heard of him today.
Correct.
Beyond the chai shop or beyond the Jahangir Art Gallery, right? So also I can take five examples. Now many people who are in theatre here or people who are not in theatre should know, people in theatre would know, that theatre actors on West End and Broadway earn more than Academy Award winning actors, more than rock stars. They're busier. You can't take a Broadway or a Western actor in your play 3 months down the line, because he's booked, signed, paid for at least for a year, at least for 2 years.
I completely agree.
Now it's a chicken or egg situation.
And also the Broadway theater tickets are much more expensive than movie tickets.
Yeah. I mean, it's a dream for every Hollywood actor to be on Broadway.
Right.
You know,
it's
Western.
$250 to $300 is a basic ticket that you need to pay for one theatrical presentation.
And you have to sort of, if you have to wait for weeks.
Right.
You just can't sort of land in London today and say, oh, this weekend I'm watching Phantom of the Opera, or weekend they'll be sold for 2 weeks. You'll get a Tuesday afternoon show, some seat behind pillars or something like that. You know, same with Broadway.
Right.
Why are they so successful? Why are they so popular? It's a pity that India gave the world Natya Shastra, but our benchmark is the West. For everything you say Broadway, for everything you say Western, Broadway for India is not the right benchmark. Broadway is mostly musicals. What I'm trying to get your attention to is the fact of the professionalism that they imply, the regimen they have.
Which we have probably failed to use.
Like sports people, like a sportsman, like...
Right.
Any corporate entity, like a bureaucrat, they go to work, they are professional. You don't find all of them untidy, shabby, ponytails, studs.
Oh, and there are big teams working with them and for them. Huge teams, massive teams.
Yeah. I mean, so they know their beans, they know that theatre is professional. They respect theatre as a profession, as any other profession, and they approach as that. Theatre for them is not a stepping stone for television or these days web series or films. Theatre is not between your intermediate and your marriage. Theatre is not between your college and your first corporate job.
Theatre
is not to hang out. Theatre doesn't mean appearances, addictions, sit and bitch about what you are doing instead of what I should be doing or what I am doing. How bad is your work? Why aren't you doing this? This is not theatre. Sadly, this is the mahol of theatre in India, wherever you go.
So is the endeavour of the Baigs to change that? If not now, at least in the next decade, decade and a half?
To some extent, we have changed that. We have changed that, and we have inspired a lot of people. We have inspired a lot of repertories. You know, a lot of people coming in, thanking us for doing that. So the endeavour continues. And it's not an overnight job. And you don't... One... Khadr Ali Beg Theatre Foundation, one Mohammad Ali Beg can't do that.
Correct.
You need multiples of them in every city, every town in the country to do that.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for that very, very insightful conversation. Wonderful having you over here, Mr. Baig and Mrs. Baig. Thank you so much, Noor. You have been phenomenal. Unfortunately, that's all the time. And as far as my calculation goes, I think we have already overshot. So either the show was so damn interesting that all of you stayed back.
Or did you advertise well for this show?
I don't know. Did you like it?
Yes.
Was it engaging enough? Did you like the lineup of our speakers who graced us with their wonderful stories today? Thank you so much. I think with that, we will call it a wrap on this particular broadcast. Thank you so much for watching Art Talks, Art Unites Hyderabad. We'll be back with their next edition in the month of April. For now, thank you so much for joining us and all the others who were a part of this wonderful show. Thank you very much. Aryan Rajput. Shravya Manasa Bogireddy. Nishchay, please come on stage. Sai. Poonam. Thank you very much for putting together such a wonderful show, guys. Rajiv and Suhas will felicitate Mr. and Mrs. Baig, Padma Shri, Mr. Baig, and Noor. Thank you so much. To do the honors for Venki Garu, Poonam, please come here. Poonam from the organizing team. Venki Garu, thank you very much. Your stories have been very, very inspiring and entertaining at the same time, Venki. Thank you. He's a wonderful speaker. Thank you, Poonam. Next, Shashi Garu, please, if you could come forward. Nishchay will do the honors for Shashi Garu. We also have Apeksha. Apeksha, thank you so much for your time. You have been absolutely wonderful to do the honors. Let me call upon Sai. And last but not the least, I would request you all to kindly stand up and give these two an ovation, Aryan Rajput and Shravya Manasa, for working very tirelessly. It was their idea, their initiative. This is only the second edition. And I think thanks to the wonderful speakers that we had today, it turned out to be a great show. At least I enjoyed it. Was I the only one who enjoyed it? No! Thank you so much.
I think we should all give a standing ovation to Ravi, who single-handedly took the show to some other level. Thank you, Ravi. You are always there. And for the next edition, you are already in. It's on 28th.
With that, we'll call it a wrap. Thank you so much, people, for joining us, and we'll see you once again very soon at the end of next month. Thank you.